It's a relief to see vaccination numbers in this country picking up a little bit in the last few days after declining for months. It's a relief to hear some of the loudest anti-vax quacks finally starting to level with their listeners about the danger of COVID and the importance of getting vaccinated. While many of these charlatans and blowhards were dreaming up bizarre theories about the vaccines, the virus was not idle. In fact, months of confusion and quackery have given the virus a chance to mutate and sadly to again regain the upper hand. This mutation, known as the Delta variant, is now in every state in the Union. COVID infections, hospitalizations, and deaths are on the rise again. Almost all of those who are hospitalized and facing serious illness and even death are unvaccinated. We know that. But this is a virus the world has never seen before, and the science is still evolving. What scientists don't know yet is whether people who are vaccinated against COVID can spread the Delta variant even if they experience few symptoms. While unvaccinated people should wear masks whenever out in public for the time being, CDC is recommending that vaccinated people who live in high transmission areas also wear masks in indoor public spaces. Further, vaccinated people who have vulnerable individuals in their households, young children or those who are immunocompromised, should wear masks in public places. And finally, the CDC is recommending universal masking for all teachers, staff members, and students in school, regardless of vaccination status. No one wants to wear a face mask. We all hope that those days were all behind us, but I'm bringing this mask with me in my pocket to be ready to use it when needed. Others should do the same. If you want to protect yourself, your family, and your community, get the jab. It's free and safe. Until then, wear the mask when you must. On another topic, Mr. President, I am saddened today to learn of the death of our former colleague, Mike Enzi. Mike Enzi was my friend. We were elected to the Senate the same year. Nearly a year and a half after pandemic losses has reminded us all that life is fragile and fleeting. Even so, Mike Enzi's sudden passing has left many of us stunned. It was less than 8 months ago when Mike came up to me on the floor and bid me farewell as he entered his retirement. As I said, we were elected to the Senate in the same year. He was a staunch conservative Wyoming Republican. I'm a proud Democrat. But over the years, we found grounds for friendship. We disagreed on a lot of issues, but we respected one another and we trusted one another. Trust in another's character and motives is sometimes seen to be in a dwindling supply in this chamber, but it's essential for the Senate to function. Mike Enzi of Wyoming knew that. He was willing to reach across the aisle and look for partners. The most unlikely political alliance I can think of was Mike Enzi co-chairing a committee with Senator Ted Kennedy, of all people, on education. Several years ago, he even reached across the aisle to ask me to join him in a legislative effort. It was one that I was aware of. Byron Dargan of North Dakota had been one of the early authors of this legislation. It was basically designed to help small businesses in Main Street America have a fighting chance in the age of Amazon. Over the years, we'd seen too many mom-and-pop stores and other small businesses crushed by competition from online retail giants, in part because of an unfair advantage. Unlike brick-and-mortar merchants, online-only retailers didn't have to pay state and local taxes. That's unfair. And it created an advantage for the online marketers over the small businesses on Main Street. Communities and states had a harder time paying for schools, police protection, and other vital services as more sales shifted to online and sales tax revenue fell. As a former mayor and retailer owning a shoe store, Mike Enzi understood well how the unfair taxing system hurt brick and mortar retailers. And it also hurt state and local governments and their taxpayers. He had a solution called the Marketplace Fairness Act to apply the same sales tax rules to all retailers. Simple, basic fairness. He asked me if I would be his Democratic partner in this effort. I agreed. Our bill passed in the year 2013. Later, a Supreme Court decision clarifying that state and local governments have the authority to collect online sales tax made our bill unnecessary. But during the time we worked together, Mike Enzi was a good partner. He practiced what he called the 80% tool. He spoke about that tool, as he called it, in his farewell remarks here on the floor of the Senate. He said, "We're all looking to make our communities and country a better place. We might not always agree on what the solutions are, but we can respect each other for working to find one." And then he went on to say, "The 80% tool is where all of our energy, attention, and talent should be focused. If we just worked on the 20% that we don't agree on and will never agree on, we will only generate headlines about how hard we are working, and nothing gets done. Just gridlock." Relying on his 80% tool enabled Mike Enzi to work with Ted Kennedy to reauthorize Head Start programs for preschoolers and tuition assistance programs for college students. He loved his state, he loved the Senate, he loved America. Mike Enzi and his wife Diana were amazing partnership too, for over 50 years, 3 children and many grandchildren. Loretta and I send our condolences to Diana. Mike was a wonderful friend and colleague in the United States Senate, and he will be missed. On an unrelated topic, over this past week, the Olympics has been an inspiring display of global unity and friendly competition. The champions representing America have taken Tokyo by storm. We've won 25 medals, 9 gold medals so far. But earlier today, we received word that one of our great athletes, Simone Biles, was taking a step back from today's competition. In announcing her decision, she cited the need to, quote, "focus on my mental health and not jeopardize my health and well-being." There is no doubt that this was one of the hardest decisions Ms. Biles has had to make in her young life. But it was not only what she viewed as the right decision, it was a courageous decision. She is the most decorated gymnast in America's history. She's an inspiration to millions of aspiring athletes and fans around the globe. And she is, by all means, a living legend. But she is also a human, a young woman who today had the courage to step forward and share her humanity with the world. She's an inspiration to all of us, on or off the mat, all in the competition or not in competition. Over the past 18 months, the pandemic has compelled each of us to appreciate our common humanity. COVID-19 has claimed the lives of too many friends and family members. It's prevented us from coming together with people we cherish, and it's put many of our plans on hold. It's caused and compounded unimaginable stress, and it's exacted an unimaginable toll. Job lost, not enough food on the table, hardship paying bills, racial injustice, all these stressors on life have been magnified. So if we can learn from Simone Biles' example today, it's that everyone has a burden they carry. And the pandemic has made many of these burdens heavier, especially for working families. I happen to think we have a responsibility, if we can, to help each other carry those burdens. Here in Congress, we as lawmakers have the power to help people. For the single mother who lost her job waiting tables because of the pandemic, we have the power to help her pay her utility bills. For the recent graduate struggling to afford student loan payments and health insurance, we have the power to make life more affordable. And for the owner of a coffee shop who's considered laying off employees to stay in business, we have the power to help him keep those employees on the payroll. To me, this is what President Biden's plan to build back better is all about: eliminating the daily stressors that keep people up all night, giving people some breathing room so that they can focus on the things that really matter. Mr. President, I yield the floor.